In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about catabolism of glycosaminoglycans. Catabolism of glycosaminoglycans. So far we had studied almost all the glycosaminoglycans. Now in our body, these glycosaminoglycans are constantly synthesized as well as constantly destructed or broken down. Constantly synthesis as well as constant destruction is going on. So there is a turnover of the glycosaminoglycans. This destruction process is carried out by the lysosomal hydrolysis. So this lysosomal hydrolysis are basically of the two types. One is endoglycosidase as well as other ones are exoglycosidase. So there are basically two types of these lysosomal hydrolysis are there. Endoglycosidase, what they do, if this is a polymer of mucopolysaccharide or glycosaminoglycans, then this endoglycosidase, they will break down these internal bonds, whereas this exoglycosidase, they can break down from the terminals of this polymer, right? So endoglycosidase are the ubiquitous in the lysosomal hydrolysis, but this exoglycosidase, these are very very specific. That means for the N-acetyl glucosamine, there will be a different exoglycosidase. For the glucuronic acid, there will be a different exoglycosidase, like that. These are the specific, whereas the endoglycosidase, these are very higher in the quantity as well as in the variety. So basically what I am trying to tell you over here is that endoglycosidase, its deficiency is rarely or almost never seen, whereas comparatively this exoglycosidase deficiency is there because they are very specific. So if one type of exoglycosidase is there and another type of glycosidase is not there, then there will be a deficiency symptoms. Actually we have very different types of glycosaminoglycans, right? So there can be a two approach to understand this catabolism of glycosaminoglycan. The one approach could be consider each glycosaminoglycan and discuss its catabolism, but this will be very much lengthy approach, so we will not take this approach. Whereas the second approach is that the consider generalized mechanism, and if we understand this generalized mechanism properly, then for the any mucopolysaccharide, for any given glycosaminoglycan, we can write its proper catabolism pathway, right? So we are going to follow this manner or this strategy. So now what should be done? So we have to understand this exoglycosidase. Endoglycosidase, these are the very simple, they will break the internal bonds of the polymer, whereas exoglycosidase, these are the very specific. And specific to what? Specific to this terminal sugar. Suppose this sugar is removed, then for this sugar, if it is different, then there will be a different enzyme. If this sugar is different, then there will be a different enzyme. So once this sugar is removed, then only this sugar can be removed. Once this is also removed, then only this part can be removed. So for each sugar, there will be a different exoglycosidase. So our strategy should be first make a list of all the possible sugar which can occur in any mucopolysaccharide, or you can say in any glycosaminoglycans. Okay, so let's first try to make a list of all the possible monosaccharide units of this glycosaminoglycans. So for that, let's consider two or three compound. Let's take up a heparan sulfate, or the similar type of structure is seen in heparin also. Okay, so heparan sulfate, we know that in heparan sulfate there is a D-glucosamine. Remember, this heparan sulfate and heparin, its structure is very complicated because they are not following general rule that I am going to tell you in the short time. Okay, then we have L-iduronic acid. These two sugars makes up a disaccharide, and this disaccharide unit is repeated several thousand times for the heparin, right? But this heparin and heparan sulfate both are highly variable structure. That means sometime what happens, instead of this D-glucosamine, many a place there is a N-acetyl glucosamine, right? And similarly with the L-iduronic acid also, at the many place, instead of L-iduronic acid, we have D-glucuronic acid. D-glucuronic acid. So, see, if you consider heparin, then the most of the time it's a D-glucosamine bonded with the L-iduronic acid. While discussing the structure of heparin, I told you that 90% of the time in the structure of heparin, it's a L-iduronic acid, and 10% of the time it's a D-glucuronic acid. But in case of heparan sulfate, this situation is reverse. Most of the time it's a D-glucuronic acid, and sometime L-iduronic acid occurs. Similarly, in the D-glucosamine, also many places replaced by the N-acetylglucosamine, right? And at all the places, all these sugars are sulfated ones. So I'm writing this SO4 just above the respective sugars. So these are the four possible sugars which can occur in the structure of heparan sulfate or heparin. Let's consider other mucopolysaccharide. Then second, let's consider chondroitin sulfate. We have chondroitin sulfate. Now this chondroitin sulfate, we know that there are four different types, A, B, C and D. Now in the chondroitin sulfate, in the structure of chondroitin sulfate, we have a modified disaccharide which is made up of N-acetyl galactosamine, and the second sugar is D-glucuronic acid. It is a D-glucuronic acid. Now what happens, there are four types, right? So here also variation can be seen. In case of A and B, this N-acetyl galactosamine is sulfated, right? In case of A and B, the fourth carbon of this N-acetyl galactosamine contains sulfate group, whereas in case of C and D, its sixth carbon, the sixth carbon of this N-acetyl galactosamine is sulfated one. All these things we had already discussed in the previous video of the structural aspects of mucopolysaccharides. In case of D-glucuronic acid, this D-glucuronic acid is present in A, C and D, except in the B it is not D-glucuronic acid, but here in case of chondroitin sulfate B, we have L-iduronic acid, L-iduronic acid, right? Now, in case of D, in case of chondroitin sulfate D, this glucuronic acid is sulfated one. So, in case of chondroitin sulfate D, this sulfate is, there is a sulfate, okay. Now, this L-iduronic acid, it occurs in chondroitin sulfate B, and you need to remember that this chondroitin sulfate B is also known as dermatan sulfate. It is also known as dermatan sulfate because it is found in the, mainly found in the skin, which is responsible for the pliability of the skin, right. So, let's consider third sugar also, third mucopolysaccharide also. This time consider keratin sulfate. Consider keratin sulfate. In case of keratin sulfate, we have this all, this is also a polymer of repeating disaccharide unit, right? So, that repeating disaccharide is made up of N-acetyl glucosamine and galactose. Remember, in keratin sulfate, there is no any uronic acid derivative, And in case of keratin sulfate, this N-acetylglucosamine, it contains sulfate group. So, I am writing it over here. It contains sulfate group. Now, these three glycosamine or glycans are enough to derive all the possible monosaccharide unit. So, let's highlight which are the unique in this. Okay. So, first this D-glucosamine is unique, right? Then we can say we have L-iduronic acid, this is also unique along with its sulfate group. Then we have N-acetyl glucosamine, this is also unique. Unique means I am just highlighting, if it occurs at the two place like this N-acetyl glucosamine, it is also appearing at over here. So, I will just highlight for the one time so that we can address that particular monosaccharide. So, in that sense I am telling you unique sugar, right. Now, we have D-glucuronic acid also here, which is also, let's highlight it for the one time. Then we have N-acetyl galactosamine, which is again unique, it is not highlighted, okay. So, I had highlighted, and this both part we can highlight it like this, okay. What about D-glucuronic acid? It is already highlighted, so I will not highlight this. What about L-iduronic acid? Yes, it is over here. We will try to highlight the sulfated part, okay, because sulfate part will require some extra treatment. And then the same process will be followed. So, L-iduronic acid and L-iduronic acid sulfate, in that place we will highlight the sulfated part. Okay, so these both are already there. Then N-acetyl glucosamine, it is already there. Then what about galactose? It is unique. So, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7 unique sugars. So, now let's make up a list of the 7 sugars. Okay, so the first one is L-iduronic acid. L-iduronic acid. The second one, okay, L-iduronic acid is here, second one is D-glucosamine, third one is N-acetylglucosamine. Okay, let's write it. The second one is D-glucosamine, it is sulfated, here also it was sulfated, so let's just write it. Then in the third place we have N-acetylglucosamine, which is also sulfated. Then we have fourth sugar, this N-acetylgalactosamine, there is N-acetylgalactosamine. So that is actually this SO4 at C4 and SO4 at C6. So this is fourth and fifth sugar, then sixth is galactose, then sixth one is the galactose, right? Sixth one is the galactose. We have total seven sugar. Which sugar we had missed? We had considered, okay, this D-glucuronic acid is our seventh sugar. So the seventh number is D-glucuronic acid. Is a D-glucuronic acid. This D-glucuronic acid is also sulfated one. Now what we will do, we will discuss these sugars one by one and which type of exoglycosidase is there, which type of exoglycosidase is there, that we will discuss, how it will act, that also we are going to discuss. So let's first start with the L-iduronic acid with its sulfated version. So the first one is L-iduronic acid with its sulfated variety. Now see, this L-iduronic acid, like this is your L-iduronic acid. This L-iduronic acid has a sulfate group, right? So there is one oxygen group is there in the L-iduronic acid. It is, this O is the part of iduronic acid, and with this sulfate group is attached, and this is the polymer of our glycosaminoglycans. So I am showing a short polymer. Now remember, remember this rule, there are always, whenever sulfate sugar is there, whenever sulfate group is there, first this sulfate needs to be removed, right? Remember this rule. And the second, once sulfate is removed, then only in the second step, then only that monosaccharide can be removed. Until till the sulfate group is there, then this monosaccharide cannot be removed. So the first step, always sulfate needs to be removed, okay, then only that monosaccharide can be removed. So now you can see, this sulfate needs to be removed first. So in our body, nature had designed one enzyme. So which enzyme can remove the sulfate? Obviously its name will contain sulfatase, right? Its name contains sulfatase, but as it is removing from the iduronic acid, that enzyme's name is iduronate sulfatase. So this is the complete name of the enzyme. This enzyme will remove the sulfate group, the sulfate group will be removed, and so what we will have, L-iduronic acid, which is still bound with the polymer, of the glycosaminoglycans, okay. Now our body can remove this L-iduronic acid. Why? Because this is not sulfated. So to remove this bond need to be broken down, and based on the name of this substrate L-iduronic acid, we have properly named enzyme, that is alpha L-iduronidase. This enzyme, what it will do, it will break down this bond, and so this L-iduronic acid is released from this glycosaminoglycan, and remaining glycosaminoglycan can undergo further degradation, okay. So let's simply show it. So this bond is broken down, this our L-iduronic acid is separated, this L-iduronic acid is separated, and this polymer is released. So now this can undergo some further processing or removal of that particular sugar. So the one part is clear, we discussed about the L-iduronic acid which is sulfated. Now let's consider a second sugar from our list. So which one is, this one is covered. Now second is D-glucosamine, which is sulfated. So So we have D-glucosamine, we have D-glucosamine, this is D-glucosamine which is sulfated one. So it's nitrogen, this glucosamine has one N atom is there, with that N atom sulfate group is attached. Now as per rule, what should be removed first? Yes, first we have to remove the sulfate group. So to remove the sulfate, what could be the name of enzyme? Obviously it will end with the N sulfatase, right? N sulfatase. And if you look closely, ideally the name should be D-glucosamine N sulfatase, right? But this D-glucosamine is actually unique to the heparan sulfate. It is unique to the heparan sulfate. So the whoever had done the discovery of this enzyme, he had given a name of heparan N sulfatase. Heparan N sulfatase. Why? Because D-glucosamine is exclusively found into the heparan sulfate. So here the name of heparan sulfate, heparan N sulfatase is there. It will remove the sulfate group. And yes, obviously this D-glucosamine is again a part of polymer, right? So now the sulfate is removed. So what we are left with? We have plain D-glucosamine. We have plain D-glucosamine. Now this glucosamine, as its name suggests, this nitrogen is already there, and now without the S it will be bound with the 2 hydrogen atom, right? Now as this is a part of polymer, right? Now the second logical step should be removal of this sugar. But unluckily in our body is deficient of the glucosaminase enzyme. So this D-glucosamine cannot be released. As such, this D-glucosamine needs to undergo some further processing. So what processing is required? So what happens actually is, there is an acetyl coenzyme A molecule is there. This acetyl group of acetyl CoA is transferred to this nitrogen atom. It is transferred to this nitrogen atom. So this hydrogen, this H2 is replaced by acetyl group, right? So this situation will be there. So this D-glucosamine, now here the N is bound with the acetyl group, and of course it is still part of the polymer because still enzyme is not there to break down this bond. Okay, so how this acetyl CoA, this acetyl group is transferred from acetyl CoA to NH2? So here we have one enzyme, and obviously it will be of transferase variety. What group is transferred? Acetyl group is transferred. So acetyl transferase enzyme is there. From where? From acetyl CoA to D-glucosamine. So the complete name of this enzyme is acetyl CoA glucosamine, acetyl CoA glucosamine acetyl transferase. This enzyme transfers acetyl group from the acetyl CoA to the D-glucosamine. And so we have now this D-glucosamine, that name is wrong, right? Why? Because acetyl group is there, and once acetyl group is attached with the glucosamine, we call this substance as a N-acetyl D-glucosamine. So let's change its name. So now instead of D-glucosamine, what should be written? We have to write N-acetyl D-glucosamine. This should be written. So this is synthesized from this by the action of this enzyme acetyl CoA glucosamine acetyl transferase. I hope this step is understood properly. Actually in all the unique sugars, this one is the extra step where we need to do some processing after removing sulfate. Rest every place, once you remove sulfate, you can go with the direct removal of that monosaccharide unit, but there is just one exception for this glucosamine step. Okay, so now this is unsulfated sugar which is not a glucosamine. It contains acetyl group. So now we have one enzyme, our body has one enzyme which can remove this part by breaking down this bond. So this bond should be removed. Which enzyme will remove this bond? So for that we have N-acetyl glucosaminidase enzyme is there. So this bond will be broken down. So now we have N-acetyl glucosamine. So N and acetyl group are shown, and the remaining polymer is separated from the N-acetyl glucosamine. So we had seen the second sugar also. So let's look at, okay, D-glucosamine is also covered. Now the third part is N-acetylglucosamine, which is sulfated one. Okay, so let's consider this. So our third unique sugar is, N-acetylglucosamine, but here N-acetylglucosamine itself is sulfated. So the sulfate group is attached with the N-acetylglucosamine, right? So, and I am showing N and acetyl group separately also, and this is a part of glycosaminoglycans, right? So I had shown this chain. Now as a rule, first what should be done? First we have to remove this sulfate group. So let's remove it first. So this sulfate group needs to be removed by one enzyme. So obviously that enzyme should contain sulfatase in its name. But from where it is removing sulfate? It is removing from the N-acetylglucosamine. So our name of enzyme is N-acetylglucosamine sulfatase. Now once this sulfate is removed, we are left with N-acetylglucosamine, which is N and acetyl group attached, and which is also part of this polymer. Now how to break down this bond? Okay, once sulfate is removed, we can remove this monosaccharide unit. So to remove it, you look closely, we had already discussed that step over here, right? So this step, let me pick up a different color. Okay, so this N-acetylglucosamine and then this N-acetylglucosamine, both are same. So now the rest, this one step will be the similar in both the cases. Okay, so our third unique sugar is covered, N-acetylglucosamine, and now let's discuss fourth and fifth together, that is N-acetylgalactosamine. In one case SO4 is at the C4 and in other case SO4 is at the C6 place. So let's look at this fourth and fifth number sugar, that is N-acetylgalactosamine. So the fourth is N-acetyl galactosamine. This N-acetylgalactosamine, and it's C6. Let's consider C6 first. It's C6 is carrying a sulfate group, and this is a part of one glycosaminoglycan, right? Which is at the terminal. This N-acetylgalactosamine is at the terminal, and the fifth sugar is N-acetylgalactosamine, and on this N-acetylgalactosamine, carbon 4 of this N-acetylgalactosamine contains sulfate group. And this is also a part of glycosaminoglycans, right? Okay. Now, what happens if you consider this first part? What should be done first? This sulfate needs to be removed first as per a rule. So, this sulfate is removed by which enzyme? Obviously, it's a sulfatase, but here it is a N-acetylgalactosamine 6-sulfatase. So, N-acetylgalactosamine 6-sulfatase, this is the complete name of the enzyme. Similarly, this sulfate needs to be removed first, right? So here like this, what should be the name of this enzyme? That should be N-acetylgalactosamine 4-sulfatase. So in both the cases, what happens is that first sulfate is removed in both the sugar. So once sulfate is removed from the both the sugar, what will be its product? Its product is going to be N-acetylgalactosamine in the fourth part, in the fifth part, both the places. So here now the terminal sugar will be same. The terminal sugar is going to be N-acetylgalactosamine, right? Now the sulfate part is removed. So that terminal sugar is the same. And remaining remaining polymer can be a different one. Now this needs to be broken down. So we have N-acetyl galactosaminase enzyme is there, but which is again which is ubiquitous, so I am not writing its name. Its deficiency is never reported, okay, so I am not writing its name, but if you just want to remember its name, it is N-acetyl galactosaminase. That enzyme is there which can break down this bond, okay. So now we have covered fourth and fifth sugar also. Let us look at the sixth unique sugar. Let us look at the sixth unique sugar, and sixth sugar is galactose. So galactose, which is a part of glycosaminoglycan, so I am showing a polymer. So this is a polymer containing a galactose at the terminal end. So this is not containing sulfate. So we can directly go for the breaking down of this bond. So what enzyme, which enzyme will break down this bond? So this bond is broken up by the beta galactosidase. It is broken up by the beta galactosidase. This enzyme will break down this bond, and so we can get galactose over here. And remaining polysaccharide, heteropolysaccharide part is separated. Okay, so we had covered six sugars. So let's look at the this galactose is covered. Now we are left with only one sugar, and that is D-glucuronic acid, which is a sulfated variety. Okay, let's see, the seventh sugar is the D-glucuronic acid. This D-glucuronic acid is sulfated one, right? So here it's the oxygen, with the oxygen atom sulfate group is attached. So first what should be done? First this sulfate needs to be removed. So what could be the name of enzyme? Obviously the name of enzyme ends with sulfatase, and here we have glucuronic acid, so we have glucuronate sulfatase. I forgot to show the rest of the polymer, so this is the rest of polymer, right? So now this sulfate group is removed by this glucuronate sulfatase. We are left with D-glucuronic acid, which is bound with the mucopolysaccharide or heteropolysaccharide or glycosaminoglycan. All things are same. Okay. So now this D-glucuronic acid needs to be removed. So what should be done? This bond should be broken down. So this bond needs to be broken down, and it is broken down by the beta glucuronidase. This enzyme will break down this bond. So what will happen? There will be a D-glucuronic acid which is separated from the rest of the glycosaminoglycan. So we had seen all the possible mechanisms. We have seen all the possible mechanisms by which your terminal monosaccharide unit can be removed from the glycosaminoglycans. Now how to apply this knowledge in catabolic pathway of the any of glycosaminoglycans? So for that, for example, let's take up a heparan sulfate molecule and find out how its catabolism could take place by this newly acquired information. Okay, so let's first draw the structure of heparan sulfate. So we know that heparan sulfate is glucosamine. So we have this glucosamine. This glucosamine is sulfated. It has nitrogen and it is sulfated. This glucosamine is bonded with the glucuronic acid. So okay, this is glucuronic acid. Again, this glucuronic acid, its oxygen atom is bound with the sulfate atom. This glucuronic acid is in turn, let's say, bound with glucosamine, but let's consider the variety, the variation, that it also contains N-acetyl glucosamine. Let's consider this, that instead of glucosamine, here there is a variation. There is a N-acetyl glucosamine, right? This also contains sulfate, and to show the acetyl group, like N-acetylation is shown, and here we don't have space, so let's show one molecule over here. This should be uronic acid, but let's consider that we have iduronic acid, okay, as a variation. Iduronic acid, we have liberty to do a variation in case of heparan sulfate. We have at each place we have two options to put. At this place we can put up either glucosamine or N-acetyl glucosamine, and at alternate place we can put up glucuronic acid or iduronic acid. I am using this all the possible variation in this four molecule longer this glycosaminoglycan, so that we can discuss very clearly. Okay, so now from this end, okay, let me pick up. Okay, if from this end our exoglycosidase is acting, then what should be first removed? This sulfate needs to be first removed. Which enzyme is there? This enzyme, this sulfate is removed by iduronate sulfatase. So iduronate sulfatase, I am not writing full name because it is already mentioned above. Now this sulfate, once it is removed, let's remove it. This sulfate, once it is removed, then this bond can be broken down. This bond can be broken down, and this bond can be broken up by the L-iduronidase. This can be broken up by the L-iduronidase, right? So now once this is removed, this glucosamine part is exposed. So let's remove this part because it is removed now, right? So now you can see the underlying glucosamine is now exposed, and we already studied about how this glucosamine can be removed. So first, this glucosamine has a sulfate. So first sulfate needs to be removed. So which enzyme will work over here? Here heparan and sulfate. Heparan and sulfatase will break down this, it will remove this sulfate, right? So once this sulfate is removed, let's remove it first. Okay, by this faster, this will be faster for deletion. Okay. So now the sulfate is removed, and now this glucosamine needs to be removed. But remember here, with the glucosamine there was an exception that we cannot directly remove this glucosamine. So first acetyl-CoA will transfer acetyl group to over here by the enzyme transferase, that is acetyl-CoA glucosamine acetyl transferase. I am not writing that name, it is already written in this video. Okay, so acetyl-CoA glucosamine acetyl transferase enzyme will transfer acetyl group to the here, right? And once acetyl group is attached with this N-acetyl, then only this bond can be broken up by the N-acetyl glucosaminidase, by the enzyme N-acetyl glucosaminidase, right? So now this much I am also deleting enzyme, so this much part is removed. Okay, this also needs to be removed. Okay, now we are here with the glucuronic acid. And how this will process? This sulfate needs to be removed first. So we have enzyme glucuronate sulfatase. It will remove this sulfate part. So let's remove it. Okay, this sulfate is removed. Okay, now this glucuronic acid, it can be removed easily by the beta glucuronidase. This enzyme will remove this glucuronic acid. So now underlying glucuronic acid N-acetyl glucosamine is exposed. Now again understand that this is a longer polymer. I had just shown the first fourth. So now this N-acetyl glucosamine should be removed. So it is sulfated. So first logical step is remove this sulfate. So what enzyme will be there? There will be N-acetyl glucosamine sulfatase. So N-acetyl glucosamine sulfatase. This will remove the sulfate, and then later on this N-acetyl glucosaminidase enzyme will remove this part by breaking down this. So here you can see by understanding the removal of each and individual sugar, we can write a catabolic pathway of any given glycosaminoglycans, right? So I think this is the best approach. And the last thing which I want to tell you is this, that so far whatever enzymes, whatever individual sugar, whatever enzymes are discussed, all these enzymes can be deficient in the different diseases. So let's just label this disease. This iduronate sulfatase, whenever it is congenitally absent, we call it as a mucopolysaccharidosis type 2. Whenever this alpha L-iduronidase enzyme is deficient, we call it as a mucopolysaccharidosis type 1. Actually type 1, the name of the disease is Hurler disease. Mucopolysaccharidosis type 2 is the Hunter's disease. Then we have this heparan and sulfatase. It is deficient in mucopolysaccharidosis type 3. But type 3 has 4 different subtype A, B, C and D. So type 3A, in this subtype heparan and sulfatase is deficient. this acetyl-CoA glucosamine acetyltransferase, this is also deficient in MPS, mucopolysaccharidosis type 3, but with its subtype C. So, type 3C, we have this transferase deficiency. Then we have N-acetylglucosaminidase. This is deficient in mucopolysaccharidosis type 3B, MPS 3B. This subtype contains a deficiency of N-acetylglucosaminidase. Then we have enzyme, this N-acetylgalactosamine sulfatase. It is deficient in mucopolysaccharidosis type 3D, Okay, so see the all the four subtypes of mucopolysaccharidosis type 3A, type A, type C, type B and type D, all four enzymes are mentioned. Now in this case, here whenever there is a deficiency of the 6 sulfatase, we have mucopolysaccharidosis 4. In mucopolysaccharidosis 4, there is a N-acetylgalactosamine 6 sulfatase deficiency. And in case of N-acetylgalactosamine 4 sulfatase deficiency, it is mucopolysaccharidosis type 6, it is type 6. So, remember, you can remember it like that, in MPS 4, 6 is deficient and in MPS 6, 4 is deficient, right? But here, one complication is there, mucopolysaccharidosis has 2 type and in type A, the 6 sulfatase is deficient, whereas in mucopolysaccharidosis type 4B, this beta galactosidase is deficient, and then we have mucopolysaccharidosis 7, in which beta glucuronidase enzyme is deficient. Remember, glucuronate sulfatase is not deficient in any of the named disease. So, from this you can understand that we have several types of mucopolysaccharidosis, we have type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, there is no type 5, remember. Then we have type 6 and then we have type 7. Type 3 has 4 different subtypes, that is A, B, C and D, and type 6 has, sorry, type 4 has 2 different subtypes, A and B. Type 4 has 2 different subtypes, type A and type B. Okay. So, regarding the mucopolysaccharidosis, I am going to discuss this mucopolysaccharidosis in the next video, but from this video you can take up the concept and you can apply it into this mucopolysaccharidosis. Although I will not keep this part, this all metabolism, this all catabolism as an essential requirement for this mucopolysaccharidosis video, but if you had understood this catabolism of glycosaminoglycans properly, then when we will discuss about mucopolysaccharidosis, you will not have any difficulties. Now, again, I am telling you that this video is not for the undergraduate medical student, but this video is only for those students or those learners who are really interested in the catabolism of glycosaminoglycans. Okay. So, I tried my best to make this catabolism as simple as possible. If you have any query, confusion or doubts, please write it down in the comment section below. And please like, share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.